The universe is loud in a very quiet way. Are you listening? Welcome to the Cosmic Whispers podcast, where we delve into the realms of spirituality, personal growth, and the cosmic dance between the third and fifth dimensions. In a world filled with noise and distractions, we invite you to tune in to your own cosmic whispers, where we can awaken our inner wisdom and embark on unveiling the authentic self and cosmic connection. Welcome to episode 13 with Julius Horsthuis. Julius is a fractal artist based in Amsterdam. With a rich background in the Dutch film and entertainment industry, Julius transitioned to become a trailblazer in fractal animation. His unique blend of abstract and cinematic animation quickly gained global recognition, featured on platforms like The Creators Project, Gizmodo, and Vimeo Staff Picks. Forbes highlighted his Fulldome film Fractal Time among the top XR experiences of 2019. Julius has crafted music videos for Max Cooper and Meshuggah, visuals for Avicii and Lady Gaga, and has showcased his work at the ARTECHOUSE NYC gallery with previous exhibits in Amsterdam, Montréal, Moscow, Hong Kong, and Sydney. His art has graced festivals like Art Futura, Art Basel Miami, Coachella, and IDFA. His goal is to create alien worlds, explore other dimensions, and craft special places that stimulate our imagination to the fullest. Welcome, Julius. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
So I actually discovered your foreign nature exhibit at the Next Museum in Amsterdam a couple years ago, and I was just like really mind blown by the experience. I remember I was in the room for maybe like an hour and a half. I'm like, I think I should maybe step out of the room at some point because I could have just been there for a quite longer time than that. So yeah, it definitely transported me to another world. I would love to actually hear how you got started, just a bit about your background, your story, and how you discovered fractal art and what drew you to fractal art as a primary medium for artistic expression.
Yeah, of course. For nature is this immersive exhibit that, you know, sort of envelops you. But that's not something that I started out doing or wanting to do. I actually wanted to be more of a film director. I wanted to, actually from a very young age as a child, I think I saw movies, and there's the whole visual aspect of a lot of, especially I guess more Hollywood type of films, really spoke to me. Not the storytelling part of it, but the visual aspect. So that is really what I sort of set out to do, and my path has been winding, but it's always been sort of focused on film. So I actually applied to film school here in Amsterdam three times, and I got rejected all three times. So I sort of started out working in the film industry just to learn the ropes from the practice. So I did camera assistant, sound assistant, lighting assistant, learning all these types of technical aspects of filmmaking, which I think became later, you know, aspects in my work too. From there, I went into VJing, which was also something that I liked, which was basically like doing visuals on like events and parties and these types of things. Like behind the DJ, you'd have this like huge screen. So I used to do that in the early like 2000s, which I really liked, but it wasn't really like a career back then, like even a career possibility. But I worked with 3D graphics when I did that. So I learned 3D graphics, which is basically like another filmmaking. It's like filmmaking, it's just not with real cameras and real lights, but with like, you know, virtual cameras and virtual lights. So I sort of combined these things. And at some point I started working in the visual effects industry for commercials and for feature films, doing everything that's not possible in camera. You sort of do it in a computer in post-production, obviously. And from there, I actually found out about fractals. I still had this creative drive to make a film. And I wrote this like really convoluted, crazy script that would have been impossible to film really in terms of budget. It would have been impossible as a first time director, but it had one scene in it where the person that was sort of realizing that her world was not real. She was actually a computer simulation. That was the script. This was before I'd ever seen a Black Mirror, but it's basically like a Black Mirror episode where, so she thinks she's real. She thinks she lives in the real world, but she's not. At some point, someone pulls the plug or something of the simulation. And so she looks outside and she sees, instead of the city, the skyline of the city that she lives in, she sort of sees this sort of starts to come down in sort of like limbo kind of thing. So I was looking for an effect that would deconstruct this whole city into this like weird kind of computer code you know, matrixy stuff, but I didn't want to do like the Matrix, the Green Rain. So I was just starting to look on the internet for effects that this would work for. And then I came upon three-dimensional fractals, which were, had just been invented. So fractals have been around, as the people will know them maybe from even the 80s and the 90s, as like the two-dimensional Mandelbrot sets or Julia sets. You have a few ones. But then in the 2010s, early 2010s, there was a three-dimensional fractal that was just discovered basically, and some software was made around it that you could do explore three-dimensional spaces. And I had seen some of the early renders that were on YouTube then, and I was just completely mesmerized. I was like, I've seen so many visual effects in Hollywood films, but I'd never seen anything like that. This was just like a completely new type of world for me. So it's like, this is perfect for that scene. So if I could just take that scene where her world deconstructs and use it as a pilot scene, and I could just make it, you know, and then maybe I could sort of get the script done. So I started learning Mandelbrot 3D in order to do that. And when I did, I was like, I don't really, so Mandelbrot 3D, sorry, is the software that I use to make fractals with. So when I did, I came to the conclusion that I didn't need to really make the script anymore. It was just enough by itself. The whole visual aspect of fractal art, it opened a whole new world that allowed me to do editing, lighting, camera work, music, everything that I liked about filmmaking. I was just able to do that in that abstract world of fractals. And that is sort of how I started with fractals. That has been a whole journey as well.
These intricate patterns and geometric shapes, how do you come up with these designs? And do you have like a process that you use to come up with ideas?
I don't feel like I come up with them. I couldn't claim to have the idea of whatever shape or geometric design I use in my head and then try to sort of flesh it out, like maybe a painter or a sculptor might have an idea in his mind and then try to give that shape in using clay or paint or pixels or whatever. This is a bit of a different process, and it's more like a journey of discovery. I often make the comparison to documentary filmmakers or even like cameramen for National Geographic or photographers, that you don't claim like the worlds, they are discoveries. So I pretty much go in completely blank. I might listen to music or I might be in a specific mood, but I just open the software and I'll just try some formulas and sometimes nothing comes out. But it's sometimes you see this beautiful shape or this weird kind of thing that reminds you either of a dream or a place that you've been, or maybe it reminds you of nothing you've ever seen before. But it does something to you, and then you start using that as a almost like a location that inspires you in order to set your little film in. I think that's sort of how I would describe my creative process.
That's very cool. Do you ever get blocked?
Oh.
There's writer's block, there's painter's block.
Yeah, I mean, I don't see it as a sort of as a block like that. I definitely have moments of some, like, you know, sometimes the last weeks that I'm completely not productive or don't do anything. Or at least you don't feel like you do anything. I don't usually worry too much about it, or I don't really think. I mean, we all know about flow states.
Right.
Obviously, that's the coolest thing if you're like completely, you know, you feel completely energized to dive in and time goes by without you knowing. That is quite rare. It's beautiful when it happens, but I definitely don't have that every day. But I'm usually okay with that because there is also a lot of things around. Pure creating is great, but then you have also day-to-day stuff, even related to the art, you know, like when you have seen it into the next museum, it, you know, a large part of it is figuring out technical aspects and all these types of things that are not so specifically directly creative in nature. Yeah, I do get, I think that I would have that kind of block. I don't feel it as such. It's just like, okay, I'm just going through time where I don't feel as creative, I suppose.
How do you aim to immerse your viewers in your work? What emotions or experiences do you hope they take away from it?
Yeah.
But I guess it's project dependent.
It's project dependent, did you say?
Is it?
Well, no, I mean, it's not really project. I mean, I've done different things when it comes to like how people experience the art. So sometimes it's just on Instagram and people just see it on a small screen. And sometimes it's like planetarium screen that completely immerses you. So that's a little bit like the next museum. You can go even further in that. And then you have the VR experience that I work in well. So it's different mediums, but I guess the same type of, because these fractals are quite specific, so there's not a whole range of emotions that you can hope to elicit. The main emotion, like maybe it's a debate of whether it is an emotion. To me, it's definitely an emotion. It's one of the key emotions. It's awe. In Dutch, we don't even have a real word for it, but the English concept of awe, something, the emotion that you have when you look up, you know, up to the galaxy and you ponder like how many light years away or how many billions of trillions of galaxies there are, and these types of things, that kind of idea, or even it can happen with math as well. If you just like the concept of infinity, and these, I guess that most people would agree that there's some sort of emotion, which I think is also maybe you could call like spiritual. And there's definitely a lot of different religions that would have capitalized on that kind of emotion.
Mind expansion, excitement, I would say.
I suppose so, yeah. I think that's the main, that's what I feel, right? So I think that's what you want to convey. It's the only thing you can convey. There's no specific sadness or happiness or other emotions or something that I would know. But fractals can also be fearful. I mean, it can be frightening. There's definitely, I remember very early, like childhood dreams when I was like fever dreams, when I was like 3 years old or something, before I even have concepts of shapes or things or people. You would have these weird kind of very abstract dreams that of like pulsating shapes, weird kind of connections between shapes, very abstract. And I'd never really placed that anywhere in my entire life until I saw fractals and was like, oh yeah, this is, but then there's like really scary types of things. So I think some people definitely told me that sometimes they do get frightened.
I mean, that makes sense to me if you're able to pull that from, you know, past memories and dreams into this other dream world that you bring to life to share with other people, which is really great.
And then there is, of course, the fact that fractals just themselves, I think they are sort of like this blank canvas for the imagination. And there are a lot of people project their own experiences onto it.
Right.
And I get emails from people that vary between like a lot of different things, that also a range of emotions that people would have that you could sort of project onto these fractals. Yeah, it's very easy to sort of, it stimulates, it sort of supercharges the emotions that you might already be feeling. And I think like that is an interesting journey as an artist to see like how could you sort of facilitate that.
See how intricate it is, and I'm like, wow, it's really fascinating where you pull that from.
I just wouldn't want to take credit for the whole fact that it's intricate is part of the mathematics of the fractal, and I would never be able to draw something like that, or it surprises me as well. So yeah, I wouldn't say I could just draw that from the childhood memory. It's more like something that I encountered when I saw it, like, oh yeah, that might be, and it makes sense maybe because the brain, you know, works in a sort of fractal way or something like that.
Another way to say it is you're translating, I guess, your dreams into this medium.
Yeah.
So you describe your intent to create alien worlds and other dimensions and special places that stimulate the imagination. How do you tap into your intuition for this?
Yeah, I think that's a more difficult question for me to tap into your intuition. Can you explain what it means to tap into your intuition?
I guess it is, in a way, tapping into your own feeling and emotion, or a gut feeling of like, oh, this is what I feel I want to translate into this.
Isn't that the opposite of flow state, though? Like if you're in flow state, because you're not conscious of anything, you're just conscious of the art that you're creating. I mean, obviously, everything comes from, you know, your own experiences and your own ideas. I mean, I could imagine that when you're actually, when I would be conscious of tapping into whatever it is, I mean, I would be almost like sitting in a seat of a shrink, on the couch of a shrink. The freeing part of it is that you're not conscious of where it comes from.
But that is quite relevant, I think, to intuition as well. Because like with intuition, you just go with it, right? Like for me, I think if I want to create something, it comes up and then I follow through and then I get into flow state.
Okay, so you're saying you start with like something conscious and then it becomes a sort of this unconscious flow state?
Yeah.
Okay, interesting.
In my experience. I mean, everyone's experience is different.
Yeah.
Especially when it's like creating.
Yeah, I think it's like falling asleep. It's like the moment you're actually working, you've already lost the consciousness. You know, you could never tell the moment that you are falling asleep, because it's like, you know, you're trying to, okay, I'm still awake now. I know I'm going to sleep soon. But, you know, when you're asleep, it happened already. So I think it's a little bit like that. But I'm not trying to really tap, or I just maybe open the software and I just try to. But when you're actually inspired and when you're actually sucked into the process, you're not aware. And if I would be, I would probably be, you know, pulled out of it again.
It sounds very natural for you then.
Yeah, I think it is natural for me. Yeah, I mean, it's definitely, I've always been, you know, experimenting with different 3D software, with filmmaking, with lots of things. And it's never been like, oh, I need to do that. It's just been, yeah, I definitely feel that it's come natural.
Have you ever felt like you need a little grounding when the full moon hits? Perhaps you want to open your third eye a bit before meditation, get your creative juices flowing for a project, or balance some womb healing? Cosmic Mama Ceremonial Herbal Teas for the Chakras can help. Our 100% organic, sustainably sourced, and caffeine-free blends are meticulously handcrafted in small batches. Whether you're looking for an herbal infusion to complement an intentional moment or ceremony, or you just want to enjoy a soothing and delicious brew, Cosmic Mama is here for you. You can support our podcast and enjoy 15% off with code WHISPERS15 on cosmicmama.co. Indulge in the magic of Cosmic Mama Ceremonial Herbal Teas and let their harmonizing essence guide you on your path of connection and well-being. In the process of creating your art, do you ever encounter serendipitous moments that lead you to new creative directions or discoveries?
Oh, yeah, all the time. Yeah, so I never set out a specific direction. So, that's not completely true. I might set out a specific direction. Sometimes also I work, you know, for a client. Maybe I make a music video and then, you know, the musical artist will have a specific thing in mind of what they feel their music is about. So they might have a color palette or anything else. So I might look into a specific direction, and at some point I will serendipities happen all the time when you play with fractals. So yeah, I encounter something that is completely unique and I just completely forget about the music video and I'll just start making my own thing with that new thing that I found. And this has basically been the entire journey with the fractals. And it's extremely fun when that kind of stuff happens.
That really is just like complete flow state and alignment with your work, which is really awesome to hear. At what moment did you know that this was your soul path? You mentioned that you were working in film. Where was that moment where you're like, okay, this is what I'm going to dedicate my life to right now. This is what is going to be fulfilling.
There's a few moments, I suppose. So it's actually almost 10 years ago. So 1 month from now, 10 years ago, I published my first fractal short film, as I called it, on Vimeo. I think the reactions to a few of those earlier short films that I got, people were just very, very positive about it. I had zero social presence. So these were just completely strangers that would just write me emails or comment or whatever, saying that they, you know, were really moved by the art. That was definitely one of those moments that made me go, okay, I've been looking my whole life for something to be creatively doing, and I've done many things, but none of it got the feedback that this got. So that's a big moment where, you know, because of course you make art for yourself as well, but it is important to bring it to people and for people to enjoy it. So positive feedback is a huge stimulant when it comes to deciding what path you go.
And being able to share that with people is very special as well.
Absolutely. Yes, that's one of the most beautiful things. So that was one moment. And it's just a few of those moments. And then at some point, from that moment, I was still working full time at this visual effects company for another 4 or 5 years. And then there was the moment that I quit and I was like, okay, I'm just going to do this full time. I'm just going to dedicate my professional life doing this and we'll just see where that goes. I think that was another one of those moments where you just have to decide, because now suddenly your livelihood depends on it, that you're going to be pursuing this. That was extremely, extremely fun as well. It's inspiring as well. It wasn't scary or anything like that to me.
Liberating also.
Oh, very, of course.
So you mentioned that your art can be described as spiritual, however, that you're not in the psychedelic culture when it comes to anything else in your art, and you actually don't consider it to be psychedelic either, or visionary. Can you elaborate on that and how you would describe your art?
Could I be a little cheeky and ask you why in the first place you do think it would be visionary or psychedelic? Why is it that to you? I mean, I will definitely answer your question after that, of course.
For me, because when I go to immersive experiences, I'm a fan of immersive art in general, mm-hmm. paired with music. So for me, it feels psychedelic because it transports me to kind of another world where I see different geometric patterns or sacred geometry or things like that. And being a psychedelic myself, where I have experienced psychedelics and the beauty of that, and the beauty of expanding my consciousness in that way is the feeling of awe that I get from the visuals.
Yeah. Okay. No, I absolutely understand. And I think that comes back a little bit to what I said about before, that people project onto fractals what their own experience is.
Right.
And I've had this a lot, but I also am aware that when it comes to psychedelic culture, there's definitely huge overlap between fractals. And a lot of fractal artists are psychonauts themselves, or they have gotten into fractals because of psychedelic culture. So I know that it's been, you know, surprising to many people that I do not dabble with mind expansion. I just, because actually it's not because there's anything against it, I'm just too scared for it. Mm-hmm. I can see these worlds with Mandelbaum 3D, but I can also close my laptop when I feel like, you know, I need ground under my feet, and I'm sort of afraid that with some things you might be stuck somewhere that you can't get out of. To answer your question, I mean, that's part of the question. It's just not, it doesn't, like, I don't come from that culture necessarily. Although I do really, I think a lot, I listen to a lot of psytrance and to, I think, music from psychedelics culture. There is something about it, about the, I guess, the many layers of music, or and about the very high detailed, like this high stimulation of your visual cortex, I suppose, that has really appealed to me. But I think it's important that these kind of, when you define yourself as sort of, you know, visionary artist or like a psychedelic artist, I think it sort of confines you a little bit, and it will also alienate a lot of people that absolutely love visual art, abstract art, but have not really anything with psychedelic culture. So there are a few of these like instances where I've created this piece, and there was like people from psychedelics culture, they were like saying, okay, I can see what you made. This is about consciousness, or it's about ego, or sort of these concepts that I think, you know, you hear a lot. But then someone else saw it. It was the same piece seen by, this was from a museum of natural history, so it was like a biologist, and she saw, you know, that I was trying to make a film about evolution and about genes and about chromosomes, and I really like that. I like the fact that it can just be this sort of like different things to different people. So that's why I only would call myself a fractal artist or a visual artist or a digital artist, which are just objectively true qualifiers. And I think that's why I sort of don't want to put that label on. But I don't mind if other people do.
No, I understand that. I respect that. The fact that you can create this and you're not part of the psychedelic culture is also very interesting. You can see how natural it is for you to create these other worlds.
Yeah. I'm like, I've also thought, because other people that are not into psychedelic culture, they also usually don't like the music, and they go like, well, you have to probably be on acid in order to enjoy this music. And I can enjoy the music without. So I'm like, maybe my day-to-day life experience is already what other people would experience, and for me, just taking extra would just, you know, would just be would be too much. I don't know. These are just some theories, but yeah, I think I there's a lot there that I think in that culture that I like, and there's also things that I sort of don't like, or that I would sort of stay a little bit more away from.
Ooh, like what? Out of curiosity.
I mean, that's really not much when it comes to, well, okay. So when it comes to, there's a lot of like faces and these types of, you know, things in visionary art. Sometimes I feel that they are something that I've already seen, and people have explained it to me. Well, you definitely need to have tried acid in order to understand why there is a, you know, these types of things. And I believe them. It's just, it doesn't directly appeal to me. And then when there's other things, when it comes to, like, I love science. I'm kind of a, you know, and then there's, I think there's a lot in psychedelics culture. There's a lot of weird theories that people have about, mm-hmm. about how the universe works that I just would not agree with, I guess. Yeah. So I love fractals because you don't need any theories. It doesn't have to mean anything. It's mathematics. Mathematics are real. They do. I mean, they're not real in the sense of that we can touch them, but they're real in the sense that they're not sort of made up or some figment of our imagination. And it's just so universal. And that's the kind of thing that I love about it. It's like universal. It transcends culture. It transcends language, all these kinds of things. And it's sort of, and it is real also how nature and the universe functions. It's all mathematics. So for those types of things that I love. And those are also things I know that I think in, you know, a lot of psychedelic culture, people recognize. It's just often convoluted with, you know, other kind of theories that I would not think are universal nor true.
You talk a lot about mathematics and your art, and fractal art often blurs the lines between mathematics and creativity. So how do you see your work fitting into the larger landscape of the art world?
Yeah, this is something I've definitely been, well, I wouldn't say struggling with, but, you know, thinking about a lot. It is difficult for any pure fractal artist to sort of claim this the same sort of art as the rest of the art world. And it's difficult for a number of reasons. It's difficult because, as I said, it's more like something you discover, yet you can't completely claim. You can only claim the wrapper that you put the fractal in, the way you show it, you know, the photo for the photographer from National Geographic cannot claim to have made the tree or the mountain, can only claim to make the photo of it. So when it comes to the art worlds, that is like one thing that's hard. Another thing is hard. It's just pure digital art has always been difficult. You can't sell it unless we go NFTs, but no one's talking about those anymore.
Good point.
Yeah. So, I mean, and also this, I mean, I was always a bit against the whole sort of artificial scarcity. When you make digital art, you want to share it as wide and broad as you can. So you don't want to sort of, you know, limit it. How do you put it into art? For me, the easiest way for me to talk about it, especially when I am at some art festival or when my work is shown in a gallery like Next Museum, and you have to sort of explain what the artist means by this and what, you know, what societal commentary you're trying to give, or, and that is something that I've always struggled with. And for me, there is no storytelling element. I'm not trying to say anything. The easiest way to explain that to me is just like music, you know, when a musician, and I don't mean songs, because songs have lyrics and they're often about something, but pure music, instrumental or electronic music, no one expects it to be about something, yet people can enjoy it, and people can enjoy different layers of it and different structures of it, and can talk about it in a lot of interesting ways that they would, but people don't say, well, what are you trying to say with this piece? And I think that's, for me, these fractals have much more in common with music. It's just visual music. It's just something that is structured. It has often the illusion of a story, but there is no story. It has a beginning, middle, and an end, and it has sort of this flow, narrative flow, but there is no narration. There is no narrative. And I think music is just a good metaphor for that. That's how I usually try to talk about it or try to think about my own work.
That's so interesting that you say there's no storytelling. Just as an observer, I'm like, wow, I'm actually on a journey right now.
Yeah, but don't you have that when you listen to music? You're in a journey.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, so that's what I mean, I think. With there's no storytelling. There's no, I don't start with, you know, a sort of synopsis or a little script. It's got everything that a story has when it comes to structure. It has the structure of a story. It has, and I, this is all conscious, like there's not a random array of fractals. I very consciously edited different worlds together that feel like they're telling a story. You're going somewhere, you're on a journey. Indeed, you're sort of pushing through one thing and it's very dark space, and maybe suddenly it opens up and then the music just starts become broader and sort of into this thing. So everything that you're used to seeing, and when it comes to other storytelling mediums like film, it's all there, but there's no there is no story. The story is just purely your own experience mapping it onto it. I think that's the sort of thing that I want to try to. So I'm very happy that you did feel the journey and you did feel the story. That's the point. But the point is not that you're asking me what was it about, and you know, because I wouldn't be able to tell you.
Like, what was your story around it? It's more like what are you experiencing from what you're producing for the masses?
Yes, exactly.
And what kind of music do you listen to?
It ranges from classical to electronic. It's really quite a lot. I listen to a lot of different genres. I've already mentioned psytrance, and I listen to a lot of film music, a lot of soundtracks. I think most of it will have, again, that it is visual music is usually how I say. So you have dance music, which is really made to dance. And you have music to listen to that maybe tells stories, which is usually songs or these types of things. And you have this sort of visual storytelling music. And this can be classical. And a lot of classical music is very visual and storytelling. Again, when I say storytelling, I mean more like the structure of story. And a lot of film music has that because it's made to a film, which is actually a story. The music itself sort of flows with, you know, has this sort of narrative flow. So I love to listen to soundtracks. But a lot of electronic modern day music is also like that. I think there's a lot of, especially when it comes to psychedelic music, it's very visual and it's very narrative.
It pairs very well together.
Yeah. So if you would listen to the music that I use for my Fractal short films, I think I've made about 40 or 50 Fractal short films over the last 10 years. They have everything from Beethoven to Spongel and to lots of different musicians that I used. It all shares that one thing that I sort of seek in music.
So the primary genre that you work with for your projects are usually electronic and soundtrack music?
Yeah.
Do you go beyond that?
No, it's pretty much that. I recently released a VR album. It's like 8 tracks, visual journeys, like the one you saw at the Next Museum. And I released it as an album like a, you know, musician's. They will have an album with, you know, 8 music tracks on it. And I was like, well, you know, why can't a visual artist do the same thing? So you could just, or 8 visual tracks, but each one is composed, original compositions that were made to the Fractals by some of my favorite musicians that I, you know, that I admire or that I was able to work with. So they also range the gamut from David Levy, who is quite classical, a schooled composer, and he does a lot of video games as well. He does, or that's his main thing. Michael Stearns, who has scored the music to the films Samsara and Baraka, which are a few of my favorite films. They're also these like non-narrative, very visual films with beautiful music. So ranging from that to Desert Dwellers and Max Cooper. Desert Dwellers are like doing a lot of like, I don't know how you sort of describe it. It's electronic music that you would maybe hear.
I'm a fan of Max Cooper. I've been to one of his shows. It's very cool.
Yeah, Max Cooper is absolutely. So he's like, that's really electronic music, but so, you know, intricate. And he there's so many layers. And he is also a visual artist. He does a lot of visual art with his shows. So he understands that. And it shows. And so that's the kind of composers and musicians that I love to work with.
Can you share any upcoming projects or exhibitions that you're working on or excited about?
Yeah, absolutely. There's quite a lot of things going on usually at the same time. I'm working on it's actually the show at the Next Museum you saw, Foreign Nature. I'm adapting it for Atelier de Lumière.
The one in Amsterdam or the one in Paris?
No, the one in Bordeaux and the one in Paris.
Ah, great.
Yeah. It's not going to be in the main hall, but it's going to be in the little side hall because the main hall is usually reserved for the old masters, Van Gogh and Matisse or whoever it is. But at the little side spot, they will hopefully, I think in February, they will start showing Foreign Nature there, and then Bordeaux would be the same. So that is one thing that I'm working on. Another thing is maybe, it's probably mostly going to be these types of immersive exhibits. I want to work on some bonus tracks for my VR album, and I'll be looking into domes a lot. The VR album is also available as a dome film. So, if, you know, like planetariums and these immersive screens are just my favorite feeling, that you're just completely immersed and there's no peripheral vision of real space anymore and it's all there. Obviously a dome in Vegas or something would be the pinnacle, but that's not on the table yet.
Not yet.
Yeah, I've no idea what's I'm already starting to see if my computers will not burn if I start to render that resolution catch fire. So it's that really, it's those types of projects that will that I'm working on mostly.
Oh, I'm excited for that. Yeah, I love Atelier de Lumière. I'm there like quite a few times a year.
Cool.
I'm glad to hear that you be heading this way as well.
Yeah.
Can you provide any advice or insights for aspiring artists looking to explore the world of fractal art or digital art in general?
That is always such a hard, that's a hard question. And it's hard because I know from experience that everyone's journey is so different, and that because especially my own journey, I never set out to be a fractal artist, and I don't know if I did whether I could have. And what I mean by that is that that's me personally. If I look into something like and I try it and I can't immediately do the cool thing, I very quickly get discouraged. Mm-hmm. And if I would start now, already having seen, you know, the work that fractal artists these days put out, and I would have to start at the beginning, I would probably never really get there. So how I work, this is for me personal, is that you start to find little niches that people aren't doing yet, so that you can feel that, you know, you're not, you know, like, I will never get that. I will never make that. So you just, but I know there's not many niches. And I was kind of lucky, I think, at some point to discover fractal art when I was also working for the visual effects company, because what I was able to do is I was able to use their render farm. They have this whole, you know, array of computers that that can render, and use the fractal art. If I didn't have that render farm, I would have only been able to make pictures. And I'm not really interested in pictures. I'm interested in this animation, because these render times of these fractals are so enormous. So there's a lot of these types of factors that are just, you know, you happen to chance upon something, and then that inspires something else. And then you sort of you sidetrack from film into fractals. And I think that's the type of thing. So if you want to start out as a digital artist and you sort of start walking the path, I think my best advice is just be open to any other type of like little side possibility that opens itself up, and then be prepared to change course and to sort of see, this is interesting, that is interesting, instead of trying to grind your way. But then again, you have other kinds of people with different personalities who might, like, they might go like, well, I can grind my way, learning to get better, and just do something for 5 or 10 years until I get super good at it. So it's so different, I think, for different people. That I think that piece of advice, it just depends on what personality it applies to.
Right. I guess you need some level of flexibility.
Yeah, for me, I do. I mean, I thrive with flexibility. I thrive with, you know, chaos. But then there's other people who hate flexibility. They want to sort of this, they would need to sort of map out
and change,
this entire,
right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, you have this you know, openness to experience. It's like one of the five, it's called the big five, the ocean, you know, psychology. And then, so openness to experience, people range on that. Some people are very open to experiences, some people are not at all.
Right. It's the fear of the unknown. So if you thrive in the not knowing, and you're able to kind of like ride mm-hmm. that wave and be okay with not knowing, think the path will be a little bit smoother. And it seems like you're very much that way.
Yeah. I've never been afraid or anything, like, you know, afraid of taking a different path, or, you know, abandoning a career path or anything like that. I think, but yeah, that's also a luxury that, you know, not everyone might have. So it's very hard to say, I think.
That resonates with me. I'm kind of the same way. I thrive in change. And if, you know, something in my career is not working, I'm okay with abandoning it and then trying something better.
Nice.
For me, it's more like fulfillment in my life. You know, I need to find something that's fulfilling.
Yes.
And as a final thought, is there anything else you'd like to share to the world?
Well, what could I share? I mean, I already plugged my VR album.
Yes. Please tell us how we can find that.
Oh, yeah. If you have a Quest 2, you need a Quest 2, or the Quest 3 just came out. So the Quest 2 or the Quest 3, it's in the so-called App Labs, and it's called Recombination. So if you search for Recombination, you will find it. It's only available for the Meta Quest. So we don't have a Steam version or anything like that yet. And it's a passive experience. It's not interactive. It's really it's like a film, but it's 3D and stereoscopic, and it's completely immersive. So I think, yeah, I'll be probably making 2 bonus tracks soon. So I'm working on that as well. Yeah, and one more thing I would share is another one of those things. I've recently started a studio. So I was always this artist working by myself in my own, you know, I have this studio in my house, just in my home. But at some point I really wanted to get a small team. I didn't immediately get a team, but I got a single person, Simeon Innetveld, and hired him. And he's now helping me out. And we find this beautiful, like, great place, studio location, close to the central station in Amsterdam. So I'm sort of like expanding. This is a whole new territory for me, like not being this solo artist anymore, but trying to, what else can we do with Fractals? You know, what can other people come up with? Interesting ideas. So this whole new chapter, I think, of my life that just started just a month and a half ago.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
That's huge.
Yeah.
Really, to hire someone.
Yeah, it's been extremely fun up to now and rewarding. So obviously, it's always hard to see like what's going to come of it so early on, but it feels good and it feels great to have this space, because I was just sitting here by myself, especially, you know, with obviously, well, everyone's sitting by himself with Corona, but for me, it's been like Corona, like for the last 5 years, sitting in my home studio by myself. And it's just a very solitary experience, which I'm fine with and I thrive with, but it's also nice to try the opposite.
Stay tuned until the end of this episode for a cosmically curated musical journey. And what about your socials? How can people find you if they want to get in contact?
I think I'm the only person with my first name and last name together. So if you look anywhere for Julius Horsthuis, it's a little bit difficult to spell, but you'll probably have it in the show notes. So then you will find me on Instagram and on Facebook and on X, or yeah.
Awesome. Thank you so much for being here. Good luck on all your projects.
Thanks so much for having me. It was great.
Thank you for being a part of our community. Be sure to connect with me by hitting subscribe on whatever platform you're listening on. I greatly appreciate your support and would be thrilled if you could leave a review. Your reviews help this podcast reach a wider audience and foster a stronger collective connection. You can also connect with me on Instagram and YouTube at the Cosmic Whispers Podcast. Thanks for listening.
Thank you.
If you like what you hear and like to check out the full set, you can find me on SoundCloud at Cosmic Mama or YouTube at the Cosmic Whispers Podcast.